You threw that one for it. Okay, so I would like to talk a little bit about what we are doing on networking and how we are using optical networks and how we are trying to evolve the network. And I thought it was like a good idea to start off with history so you guys could understand where we are and how we actually ended up there. A couple of years ago, in 1992, we built the T1 network that was a fully meshed network, and it was like way too bandwidth. T1s all over the place, spanning the U.S., and we needed to interconnect that, and at that point in time, I think there's at least one other person in the room here, we needed to interconnect networks, and we ended up creating something really funny, which was a bridge Ethernet that was at three locations in D.C., one at the College Park, one at the Union Station, and one at the Sprint Hop in D.C., and at that point in time, UUNet was also located at the Sprint Hop. So we shared this, and we created something called MAE-East, which I think everybody has heard about by now. So this is how SprintLink started. We also had another network on top of it. Oh, this is funny. We had a little network here that was actually doing some of the international stuff. Traffic grows, and T1s were not very useful. The router became replaced by better boxes. In the first picture, there was only one TP circuit. That was about what the router could handle. We added more routers, and we added faster circuits. We went through this trouble of getting DSP circuits, which were tiny fast. And we interconnected the routers in the POP using FIDI. And everybody who has played with FIDI knows that that's 50 megabits full duplex. So it gets full. The next thing we did was we got switches. And those are a license one. We got big giga switches to basically separate or isolate or do something intelligent with the traffic load inside the POP. This is where some other carriers diverged. Basically, the architecture up here was pretty similar to whoever you were talking to. At this point, we diverted. We put the big giga switches in. Some people put ATM switches in. So we had the DSP circuits on multiple routers that were forming the backbone, and we had FIDI, and the transit FIDI, the green part here, was also a section of the giga switch. Our router vendor and our switch vendor figured out how to make FIDI run at full duplex between the switch and the routers. We actually got the 100 meg interconnect thing, which is almost OC-free. But in this time frame, it was kind of okay, and it saved us some other problems that we didn't want to run into. Now, the DSP were full. Okay, what do we do next? Well, we have to introduce new technology here and some new stuff, and people before me earlier today have been talking about some of those technologies, and I'm just going to not go very deep into how it works. I'm just going to fill in some bits and pieces so you can figure out how you turn it into them. Inside Sprint, we have what people call a 4-fiber PLSR. It's basically bidirectional line switching wings. So there are 4 fibers connecting anything. So if you imagine the world having 2 POPs, there are 2 fibers going north path and 2 fibers going south path, and they're working at protect in both directions. There are actually 4 fibers doing the job of one. The reason for having 4 fibers instead of, you can build a SONET system with just a point-to-point link, 2 fibers, okay? And if you cut it, you're lost. You can have a 2-fiber system, and somebody earlier talked about how they were going to put SRP on top of a network, and it looked like they were doing a 2-fiber protected network, but that means that you have to reserve half the bandwidth on both paths for backing up the other side. And then you can have 4 fibers, and then you don't really need to reserve anything, but it costs you a lot of fiber spans. The other reason for doing 4 fibers is that you don't really have a routing protocol inside SONET, so you really have to do really ugly things to make switching happen when you have a failure. We'll look at it a little bit later. Those SONET networks are great. They look like virtually perfect circuits. Like, whatever happens in the middle, it always stays up. And if it breaks, you will get a burst of like 50 to 70 milliseconds of garbage before the network has switched on you. It's great. It's really great, and it was built to keep void switches happy. But for IP, maybe we can do something better. This is the way our nationwide SONET network is built, and they also have made up in topology. If you're having OC12 circuits going between two routers, A and B, you end up provisioning the active path or the working path one way. So you're coming off the router. We're going to talk about this intersection a little bit later, okay? But you're going across the network this way. So assume that we got, it's unlikely to get a fiber count that only takes up one pair, but say that we get equipment failure, say that the laser failed on this circuit. What's going to happen is that the two nodes next to the failure will switch. So the time it takes to move the circuit over is the time it takes to detect if we're getting garbage in. Either if the light totally goes out, it happens immediately. If we're getting bit error rate going up, you have to wait a while before your error counter kicks in. But we're going to make the switch, and we're going to make the switch as close as possible to the fault, because that way we don't need to propagate the topology to the rest of the network. For the endpoints, the only thing they see about what's happened here is that they will see a sort of short burst of errors. Okay. Now, most likely, they're going to take a backhoe and take the entire fiber. And what happens if you have a four-fiber network is that it will actually loop. So this guy here, which is closest to the failure, will run the circuit this way, and it will go all the way back to this guy who knows that the circuit is broken and go all the way out. So basically, we double the length for the circuit. But we were looking at restoring the circuit as fast as possible, and this is the fastest way we can restore it, because the two network elements that understand what happens are the one next to the failure. If you are connecting routers and SONET equipment together, there's something called two-fiber handoff and four-fiber handoff. And if you do four-fiber handoff, you have working and protect. There is no difference between working and protect. It's just they're called working and protect. Okay? And if you're looking at the SONET network, they're called east and west working and protect. The way it works is, like, you have some kind of signaling between the network and your routers. Okay? And there are two ways of doing the signaling. The telco people decided that they are the center of the universe. So if you're doing what they call unidirectional signaling, the ADM drives this, and it is the thing making the decisions because it's the center of the universe. And it will only tell you about its decisions. So if you are getting a SONET OC for you on the bound circuit and it's unidirectional signaling, there is nothing you can do to tell the network anything. The network will send the information on both the protect and the working about the topology of the network. That means that the network will actually use one of those and transmit out towards the other end of the circuit, and you get told by the network in K1 and K2 which one is being used. And there are ways of doing this 1+1, and you can also have up to 14 circuits and one protect, and it can tell you, look, you're not being the protect for circuit number 5. If you're running on the green one, the only way to change to go to this side from the router side is to send signal degrade. Basically, you send bad signal. You get lots of CRCR checksum errors on the SONET overhead. You can send some signal, path overhead, path AIS, line AIS, loss of signal. This is basically unplug the fiber, and it would actually switch to the other side, and it would stay there, or it may try to switch back. If you are in a unidirectional environment, you really want to have non-reverted. Otherwise, if it tried to switch back every 15 minutes without talking to you. So it doesn't really know if it's okay, because if the receive failure was going towards you, it doesn't know that it's broken. Okay. The other way of doing this is to have bidirectional signaling, which means that we are sending stuff in both directions. But we are only sending stuff from on the protect side towards the network. Now we've got a set of commands where this guy can tell the network what it wants to do, so they can talk to each other. What's the feature of doing this? Well, first of all, I can tell the network, don't switch. I can also, if this router here detects that this router here for some reason went out for lunch, but it's still sending good framing, there is nothing that would force the network to switch, because the network doesn't know anything about IP and routing and stuff. And so the only way in a unidirectional configuration is to turn off the light or send out some signal. Okay? In a bidirectional configuration, well, this router can say, my body over there is dead, and send a command in K1 and say, please switch. And the network would switch and use this guy. So basically, this intersection looks like an electronic monkey. It doesn't do anything more intelligent. It can move the cables back and forth. There are some tricks to this electronic monkey, but so a switch can either be done by command or the traditional ones that is detected as something broke. So how does it look internal to the network? Well, if we have a circuit, so the logical circuit goes from Stockton, in this case, to Pennsauken, okay? And it's provisioned as one circuit across the network. All the protection signaling is done local here and local here. If you switch on one side, you don't switch on the other side. There's no reason for causing extra interruptions. Okay? So assume that things are working the way they should. We are taking bits of this guy, okay? And the network here looks at bits coming off this router here. It looks at a signal quality in this point, and it looks at a signal quality in this point, and it may be okay, but it decides to use the working one. So we're going out towards the network. It takes the signal from the working and sends it across to the other side of the network. This ADM will take the signal and make a copy, and it will send the same bits to this guy and to this guy. So the working and the protect router receives the same bits. If you don't have any other protocol turned on, like keep alive and hellos and God knows what, you have the world's fastest packet replicator here. Because whatever this guy receives, the same packet gets received to this guy and it is sent out through the network. And the way to avoid being the world's fastest packet replicator is that you're looking at the signaling coming off from the network in K1, K2, and decide which router is active, because the network will tell you that it's actually running on this guy and this is a dummy. So this box here has to look at signaling and say, I'm not in the loop, I'm just sitting here sleeping. Okay. So if something happens, let's assume that we pull the fiber here. Okay. So light goes out on this side. Poof. It switches. And the only switch that is really visible to the network is that instead of receiving from this guy, where we pulled the fiber, it can't receive anyway, it's not going to receive from this box in the bottom. This box has to figure out that, oops, I now became active, and that information comes in K2, it tells him, no, it comes in K1, it tells you are now the active guy, okay? So this box now knows, turn the interface up. And this box may have died, or it may have pulled the fiber, so it will know, if it actually receives bits, it will know that, okay, I'm no longer in the loop, so it can turn the interface down, and if the box is dead, it's gone. There are three ways of doing this on the router side. If you go talk to your friendly telco people and you say that you're going to run the working and protect into different boxes, they're going to bring people that white suits and come in cars that say wee wee for you, because they think that working and protect are going to the same box, because they are like, this was designed to protect the case that the bulldozer runs across the building. Okay? As everybody here knows, routers never crash, okay? So that's the problem. We want to deal with two problems. We want to deal with failing optics. So this is no good, because this is nice. If the optics fail here or the bulldozer runs across the top, we are fine, okay? We got protection. This is kind of better. If this line card breaks, we got some redundancy. But this is actually the best solution, right? Because now we got this electronic monkey that will move my important circuit from one router to another for me. So we got the protection stuff working in both directions, both as an advantage for the network people and as an advantage for me. But it's really hard to make them understand that you run into the same box. I had to fight this war with our certification lab, and I can tell you stories. Okay. Then we have another toy that was created called Packet Over SONET. Packet Over SONET is kind of slightly hard to understand if you really want to read one standard, because it's scattered all over the place. Bottom line is, you need some kind of framing, okay? Everybody has heard about HDLC. With HDLC, you do bit stuffing. You insert bits and you delete bits and you say flag is 6 once in a row. Doing that at OC3 or OC12 or OC48 speed is really hard, and it makes your hardware really complicated. Another way to do it, to reduce the amount of the speed you need to worry about things, is to do it on a byte level instead of a bit level. So this is actually looking at bytes, and I think we're using 7C as an escape character. So if you're seeing a 7C, it's a flag. So the only way to send 7C across the wire is basically take the 7C and then XOR the 7C with it, whatever you want to send after it. So we are doing it's byte synchronous instead of bit synchronous. Everybody who is old enough to be playing with deck gear has heard about something called DDCMP, and the only difference between this and DDCMP is they are not doing the XOR game. Last year, we got T1X1, which is the ANSI committee that worries about SONET standard, and ITU-T G707 to actually put packet over SONET into the standard, and also the way of doing scrambling, because all those transmission systems, they were designed to carry numbers of DSOs or phone calls, and there's no way an OC3 carries like 1,920 voice calls. There is no way of controlling the content of all those 2,000 phone calls. But here, all the bits that comes in the string comes from the same packet. So you can actually cause whatever pattern to go out of the router onto the wire that you would like to desire. And like SONET people didn't think, so their scrambler that actually tries to make up for this is so stupid that you can actually emulate that by putting the right pattern in. You can make pause go, basically force a loss of signal, a loss of clock. And this was fixed by putting a scrambler in to make it so hard that you can't generate the packet that would cause the network go down. And this is when we got the standard people involved, and they were actually being very helpful. So I think this is the only internet standard that actually goes into a telco standard. Anyway, PDP have lots of things we don't want, or things we want and don't want. So in reality, what these four we are using at Sprint is we are having a header, and the header is a 16-bit Ethernet identifier. So it's this 2 bytes are basically redundant. It says 0800, which is IP. And if it's IMI spoken, it says something else, which I never remember. And then there are keep alives. But this is waste of 1 byte. It could be compressed into one. And then we're having the payload, the things that people pay us for. And then we have a CRC32. CRC16, if you're running CRC16, you may have an undetected error on an OC12 circuit every, 400 years. So that's not good enough. All right, back to reality. So after the DSP circuits, we needed to insert faster circuits, and they are called OC3s, right? And with a little lesson here, we now know how to handle the OC3s. What we did was, those were 7500 routers. So what we did was, we took the working, and we put the protect in another box. And we had a working and a protect, and a working and protect, and we spread them out. And then you put your routers in a ring in order to interconnect them. So all this is point-to-point packet over SONET. Tony Bates called it the ring of fire. You can't make the ring bigger than 6 because then the hot spot is going to be your interconnect thingy. So there's an upper limit to how big you can make this, and it's basically the amount of bandwidth you have in the middle and the performance of the box. I think Bill really knows how to run the presentation. Okay, now we need to make this go away. Poof. Peering is another thing. I don't want to go into the politics, but do the following numbers. If you have a OC48 network and you have a 10% market share, you need 9 more OC48 circuits out of every pop going to others. So peering is not something you attach to the customer side, you have to attach it to the core because they're actually part of your core. We wanted to reuse our investments. So what happened was that we put this new stuff, we put it on top of the old network. We kept the old part of the old network, and we basically do what you do in the garden. I think it's called the compost. You put new stuff on top of the old stuff, and you take the older stuff and you throw it away. So this was 1996, and it actually took us into 1997. It was like a hard limit. It's going to die N97, or fourth quarter 97. So we had to do something. So what do we do next? Well, we got bigger routers. So we got the bigger routers. And remember, we have all those routers sitting here with point-to-point POS interfaces going in a ring like this, and then we had the wide area interfaces. So what we did was we took out 2 cards, and we kept one going this way and one going this way, and that way we connected this box that used to be the backbone to the new backbone that was OC12. And the OC12 is like, you know, every circuit is working in protect. Pretty clean and simple. And if you look at it this way, if you look at the wide area circuit, you have the 2 routers, and your SONET network, you have a working and a protect. Now remember that working doesn't mean we are running on working. Protect doesn't mean it's a spare. Depending on what happened in the network, if you reload the box, if you know somebody pulled the fiber, if you look into it. Something. Don't look into laser beam with the remaining eye. It switched. Okay. So over time, your circuits may be randomly distributed over your routers. You really don't know where they are. You can manually, if you have a bidirectional system, go and give a command to routers to force it over to one side, but it will cause you an interruption. And you really don't want to do it that way. So whatever happens, you leave it that way. So the worst thing that can happen is that this box are transit routers. And circuit and traffic is coming in from one side, going out the other side. So if you get half of the circuits on this box and half of the circuits on this box, you have to make sure that you have enough bandwidth in between to bridge them. We are deviating from the standard a little bit. The telco people assume that you have the same circuitry as they are having on their side, on my side, on the equipment side, which means that they're expecting the same bits to come on both circuits. And if the same bits are coming on both circuits, you don't need to really worry about K1, K2 working because they came out, they are bridged out of the same signal. So it doesn't matter which side they, it doesn't matter if they are listening to working and protect, if I'm listening to the other one. But in our case, we have this problem, we have to turn one router down. So we actually have to force them to conform to their own standard, which is really hard. Some of the ADM vendors are very useful. They are sending zeros in those signaling bytes and don't tell you what they're doing. This is another problem. So we are diverting from the fact that we are not going to the same box and we're not sending the same bits, but if you're following the standard the way the standard is written, it should work, and it actually works. I don't know, at least 7 different ADM vendors where this works. This way of doing it, we got protection both for the circuits and for the routers. And it's very nice to be able to type reload to router and it will switch, and you don't need to worry about it. Okay, so at 6:22, network is full, and we need to do something, and we need to upgrade the circuit. What do we do next? Well, as some people have been pointing out here, let's remove some stuff. Let's remove the extra equipment and try to get as close as possible to the fiber with the router. You end up with a new bag of discussions of issues you have to talk to people about. But we are still using SONET framing, but no SONET network element, and it's not entirely true, because if you're going long haul, you have to have something called regenerators, something that cleans up the signal along the path, because if it was just a long, long fiber, nothing would come out on the other side. Those things are also SONET elements. They're expecting to understand what's coming in, because in order to clean it up and fix it up, they have to know how it should look like. Okay. Why are we not using GigE is a question I get like 5 times out of 9. Well, GigE has MQ equals 1500, or could not. Okay, but you have to have a switch, and the switch is designed to do a totally different buffering environment than what we need in the core. And then we don't have any maintenance functions. Like in SONET, we have this overhead which has all sorts of bytes that are used by equipment along the path to check the integrity of the signal, to verify that the signaling there, sending out-of-band signaling information to a network element along the path, and actually do lots of stuff. So if we're using SONET framing, we can tell that the circuit is broken before we even try to send any packets down it, because as soon as it breaks, it will take it out of service on both sides. If you're using GigE, you don't know that it's broken before you try to use it. And then it's too late. And there is no real cost benefit. The costs are different, are elsewhere, sorry, think. Okay, marketing slide, think. Now, dense mode, wave division multiplexing, dispersion transponders and amplifiers, and VRs. What do we need to make this work? Well, dense wave division multiplexing is a way where you take this fiber. They were very happy. They had OC48, 2.4 gigabits running over a fiber, and it was shiny. And suddenly somebody realized, why don't we do as the radio stations? Like, you know, you can tune and put them side by side, so you can different channels in parallel. And right now, we used to be the people that consume bandwidth faster than people could create it, like routers couldn't keep up. The WDM people can create bandwidth faster than we can consume it, which is really interesting. Hopefully, they keep up for a while. Anyway, so if you're doing dense wave division multiplexing, it means that we're going to send different channels along the same fiber with different colors, and I think Larry covered most of the details. There is nothing that says that each wavelength needs to have the same signal as the other one. The only requirement here is that all the equipment on the same wavelength down the path has to understand what's going on. And right now, common speed for this is 2.4 gigabits, which is OC48, or 9.6 gigabits, which is OC192. Well, what are the limitations? Well, it's the type of fiber. The fiber is already there in the ground. This is the thing that takes the most time and the most money to replace. Okay, so whatever the fiber is doing on a single OC48, we can make copies of it, multiple OC48, as long as we don't space the channels so close that we get into modulation products. The condition of the fiber, the power loss, like was the guy smoking when he was splicing the fiber, yes, no? So you really don't know on a given fiber path how good or bad it is. You have to try or measure it. There are submarine systems that have been built that go like from here to Sweden or from here to the UK. There are 4,000 miles and there's not a single piece of electronics down there except for lasers that are doing this amplifying stuff. So you could actually, with very expensive fiber, put out the correct way. And what they do is they put fibers that are chromatic dispersion are like the first segment is inverse of the second segment. So you can't really tell how fast or how long you can go. You have to try. It depends on your fiber. The all this dispersion talk about different wavelengths traveling at different speed and what is actually happening? Well, what happens is when you send a pulse into the fiber, on the received side it gets widened, okay, and it gets noisy. This thingy here doesn't look as nice. It comes out like this and it starts to move back and forth and becomes fuzzy. All this analog stuff. But as long as you're putting in a pulse and you can actually see a pulse coming out at the other end of the wire, you're fine. If your fiber is too long and you send in pulses and you see nothing, one pulse coming out, you went too far. So there are two problems, right? We are losing power, which we can fix with an amplifier. And by accident, they figured out that they did this classical thing. We take this glass and we, by accident, put this shit in there and suddenly it became an amplifier. The bad news is that this amplifier only works in a small window around the 1550 nanometers, and that's why they're trying to space everything on there, because you have like the amplifiers work there. The fiber has a wider band. Actually, there's more bandwidth in the fiber, but we don't know how to amplify it. Anyway, if you do something like this, it will actually get the power level back. But whatever comes in comes out. So if it's shit in, it's shit out. Okay. So that means that for every segment of fiber, the signal gets noisier, and like you know, this is like copy tapes, like VCRs, and this doesn't even have copy protection. All right. So how do we use this? Well, we come off the equipment in the POP, which is either old ADM or it's a router or something. It either speaks 1550 or it speaks 1310, and it usually doesn't matter. It's a broadband receiver. Okay. Some equipment actually cleans up the signal here, but it's not really needed. Okay, you have another laser which runs on a very well-defined wavelength. Those wavelengths are made up because they are usually spaced by 100 gigahertz for 9.6 gig systems or 50 gigahertz for 2.4 gig systems. And Larry told me it was 0.6 nanometers for 50 gigahertz. So the numbers that comes out here are have lots of decimals on them, at least two. It doesn't really matter. So this is a very good laser, very narrow band, very stable, maybe sit in a very expensive environment like the temperature control and stuff. So you end up having a very nice signal. Looks like one tree in the desert, okay? One. So you take a bunch of them and you group them together. So whatever goes in here is the ATM switch, here's this old SONET gear, here's a couple of routers, and you put them all together. And the optical combiner is just a piece of glass where it's a prism, right? If you put the signal in, at some angle, the different wavelengths would show up. So you have to put the connectors there. It's pretty simple. And you get a thing out that looks like multiple trees equally spaced in the desert. Now, on the receive side, there are two problems. Like, if the receive side may be in the middle of nowhere. Eugene, for example, it's actually an example where Sprint fiber that goes from California up to Seattle terminates. And because we can't go all the way without giving any signal, we have to clean up the signal. And that's done by taking the signal in, and we have what people call the free R or regenerator. It retimes, it reshapes, and resyncs the signal. So this is basically the signal cleaner, and this is the thing that has to understand what's going on. So if you're doing SONET framing, it has to understand SONET. If it's gig ether, it has to understand gig ether. And it puts it out on another transmitter. If it's a re-end site in the middle of nowhere, it puts it out at the same wavelength it came in. If it's a terminating site, it puts it out at either 1550 or 1410 to go into the terminating equipment. Okay, on the receive side, you take the signal in, you have this prism thingy, and you put connectors on it, and you get the different wavelengths come out. Again, those are exactly the same thing as on the transmit side, so you can actually take one fiber and run both directions, using different wavelengths in each direction. Okay, so the input side, you have multiple channels. Poof. So we got input side that takes the okay, buys a beer tonight in the bar, go see this guy with a phone, and he buy you a beer. You take the input side, okay, you put all the elements together, you may have some amplifiers, you take it apart, you clean up the signal and send it out to the equipment. So from here to here, or from this side to this side, it looks like a piece of fiber local to the building between two routers. So if you buy a transponder-based WDM system, you don't really need to worry about what's going on in the middle. So how do you turn this into an IP network? Well, you take two routers, each sends over a WDM path, or path over WDM, that basically looks like a dark fiber, it just has all this electronics in it. Telco people love clocking, they talk forever. And they're having bits timing, they have their central clock in a very famous place, and it's all sorts of complicated stuff, which we don't need any of, okay? So they get really bonkers. And there is only one requirement here, that when they have this test set and they plug it into the middle and they want to watch the bits going both directions, the test sets, most of them assume that they are clocked by the same clock. So if you have the clock on this side being the router, the crystal oscillator on the router card, and the router card on this side clocking in another direction, the test set would go bonkers. So the easy way of not having to fight that war is to turn one side of this point-to-point link into loop timing towards the other side. But every point-to-point link runs independent of everything else. All right, so what you really end up with having is you have a router with a line charge here that clocks the bits coming out, going over to this side, recover the bits in the clock, use that clock to send it back, because if somebody plugs something in the middle, both directions look the same. We got a point-to-point link. If you're in telco, there are different organizations, and I also want to show, in our case, we have what we call the Internet Service Center that runs the router, then we have the people that runs their fiber backbone that runs this piece, and then we have the routers on the other side. And basically, we can monitor both sides on what's going on. We are watching B1 parity errors in both directions, and we can tell power levels, and that's about it. And everything else, you need to send somebody out in the field. On the other hand, this is so simple that it very seldom breaks. Okay. Back to the story. How do you build a network out of this? Well, right now we are in final phase of getting what I'm showing deployed. And it's based on WDM, and we are having a couple of vendors of DWDM stuff out there, and not really our department that deals with it. We have to get the circuits. We're having BFRs. We're looking at putting in BFR pluses. And we are doing OC12 to customers today. How do you build a network? Well, here's what we did. We identified the Sprint POPs. We had to stay on our fiber, right? So we identified the POPs that had left large traffic flows. And the SONET people already built this four paths for us. So we have working protect east, or working and protect the top one, and the working and protect bottom one. So we said, okay, let's use the two workings on diverse paths. Okay. So then we get point-to-point links, and we put them in different routers to get redundancy. And then we figured out that if we actually broke one of those circuits in the middle on the same box, we would get the possibility of interconnecting all those point-to-point links in a way that makes sense. And when we run out of bandwidth, we can just equip the protect sides. And so if you look at this over the way of having the SONET network to do protection switching, which we are now doing with the routing protocol, the saving is 100%. So what we did was like this. This is one path, okay? So this is considered one circuit, okay? Between this POP and this POP, we needed a circuit. We put one, which is the north path, in one router, goes this way, comes out here. We put the other one in another router, and it goes the south path. That way, if this breaks, we're fine. If the router breaks, we're fine. And we interconnected the routers with OC48 point-to-point links. We, at some places, took one of those workings and run it through the same box. This is not an endpoint of any circuit. We just want to tap the bandwidth, right? So we don't want to put those two ends in different routers for redundancy inside this POP. And if we did, we were going to put traffic on the interconnect, so that won't be any good. And if you run out of bandwidth, you remember the four fiber picture I had, which is actually how the fiber plant look. We can actually do this. This has a very interesting effect on topology for routing when something breaks. If you cut this path here, the topology doesn't change. You just lose half of the bandwidth. So rerouting only has to be done in the box that lost the circuits. So taking all those bits and pieces and put them together, this is one city, okay, that talks to this city. Here is working one, here is working two, here's another city, working one, working two, and then here is a city that talks to another city, and we broke working one. That way we formed a real network. Another thing that happened was that we are using this, right? And we are having something like this, and we're using a large amount of ports on those routers to interconnect to the access boxes. By going to something like DPT, which was talked about earlier, we actually reduce the amount of ports used here, and we get slightly more flexibility on how to configure the access boxes. So the entire system looks like this, and this is the access routers that talks to the backbone routers. And if you wonder why I did this so funky, it's because I want to do the spatial reuse thing. So whatever bandwidth I'm using between those two access boxes and the backbone box, I can reuse here. Okay? Instead of just making the graphical nice picture, because that way I would just blow away bandwidth. Everybody looks at this, but also realize that this box is the box doing load sharing. So we're using those two circuits in parallel. Under normal condition, we are pushing traffic over both. And this guy here sees two equal paths going across this box to the customer box on this side. So load sharing is done by the access side, not by the core side, because if you end up in the core side except for this box, if you end up here, for example, it would take this path. And when something breaks in that circuit, I have half of my traffic that I need to convert to my routing protocol. Think. Everybody knows this country. Okay. So here is our OT48 topology as what we are building right now. And if you look here, like, this is one city called Tensalkin that has two circuits, a city called Stockton, and those are the two diverse paths. But you end up seeing that this is kind of a spaghetti, but it's a great network, and it's like six times bigger than anybody else right now. Routing architecture. We're using external BGP to talk to the outside world. We're using IBGP to carry all external routing, including interfaces for customers, which means that our IGP has only loopbacks and physical interfaces and boxes, nothing else. We're using ISIS. We're using BGP in a non-sync, so it's recursive lookup for everything. The core boxes, those boxes, act as route detectors, so those are route detector clients. So the IBGP mesh only consists of the 23x3 boxes. And we are using BGP communities the same way everybody else does to tag things for peers, customers, or whatever you want to do. We are using IP routing for IP over optical uses IP for reservation. This is a network as it was designed 20 years ago using Hutton protocol. We're not using any fancy underlaying stuff because it must make life complicated. You try to explain this to your carrier people, they would scratch their head and say, we don't understand. The buzzword is layer 3 protection switching. Translates to ISIS. So we are using both paths. We have red turned on, but it's not coming into play because the network is provisioned in such a way that we have enough bandwidth in there. It's actually easier to put bandwidth in there than trying to do something complicated. But if you actually end up having to run a circuit hot, you really want to do the best thing. I mean, you're not supposed to run a circuit hot, but if it happens, you really want to do the best thing. And the best thing we know today to do the TCP flows, which is the majority of the traffic, smooth distribution, whatever it's called, is to use red. And in order for customers to drive OC, like 300 megabit TCP streams, you have to have really low packet drop rates across your network. So per hop, we were looking at this, including the routers and everything, pair of errors on the circuits. Otherwise, you can't do high-speed stuff. There are other technologies out there that saves the same problem instead of installing circuits, but I really don't know how it works. But if the cab driver takes me around the city over T1 circuits, I don't need to pay. Wrong way, I think. This is what we are working on for traffic restoration. So when something happens in the network, and looking at the circuit and say, okay, SONET is doing 50 milliseconds is total nonsense because, well, that doesn't matter because we have end user who is doing voice over IP, and they don't really care about that I restored this little circuit in the middle. They want their packets to come back. So the interesting thing is from CPE box or from customer box to customer box, how fast can I restore my traffic or their traffic when something happens in the network? And it turned out that this is like tricky, but we are working on this curve, and we are shooting for one second convergence time by the end of this year, and I think we are doing great. I put the stake in the ground and said it doesn't make any sense to make it faster than 300 milliseconds because people are used to shitty connectivity nowadays because they introduced this thing called PCS phones. So we don't need to be better. But driving it further down here actually becomes a theoretical exercise that is really hard. So if you build a network this way, you're trying to push the application-specific things to the edge. Quality service is something we do at the edge because we can't keep track of it in the network. At least if you want to grow your network, you're going to see billions of flows, and if your core of the network has to worry about it. I'm sorry. This building is for the memory for the router, and this is the router. So this is not a network topology. This is like how we looked at it. When I was a kid, we had IPv4. It said packet may be delivered, maybe, sometimes, maybe. And this is what we have here. So this is the transport core, and if you want to do stuff, you can probably do it at the edge. Like if I want to do really shitty service, I know how to configure my box to do that. I need to translate this one. Somebody from one of the companies said, they were asked why they were doing ATM, and they said, we have to feed the ducks in Denver. For home market, we are looking at smaller CPE boxes because having LC48 and Gigi into your living room makes a little bit of noise. We have a trouble ticket open with the vendor saying, actually opened by the person who has the living room saying, CPE makes more noise than Peter. Another thing that we wanted to do that we thought was the right thing to do is to deal with multicast. And we started off with a little slightly different approach than other people. Said, look, there's nothing special with multicast. Yep, make it work. That was simple to say. So we said, let's make multicast part of a normal service. Our service is delivering IPv4 packets, unicast or multicast. We don't really care. You can't do this by doing the way of making that progress or making it happen is to put it in the same network. Using the same tools, make it look like everything else that the NOC people and everybody is dealing with, because if it's special, sorry, we can only fix it Wednesdays when a guy doesn't understand how it is working. And we wanted to make multicast part of our normal things, and we actually succeeded, which was kind of interesting. Why do we do native multicast? Well, we don't need any external equipment. We don't need to buy anything. We just need to make what the router vendor promised years ago work. We can use our existing stuff. We can actually do this on any of our networks. So that's what we call scalable. And people debate if you're going to charge people for multicast as a service, but I mean there are direct savings for one to many, and those are the most common applications. Okay, multicast as it's built today, the standards-based way, is not very efficient for doing small groups, many small groups to many small groups. But I think there are ways that we have looked at recently that we can actually turn the paradigm we have into something that can actually deal with this. But right now, the majority of the applications people want to run is one to many. So we thought, okay, let's do that. We wanted to make standards. We wanted to use standards that are in the IETF so that we can use any vendor thingy, and we can go people and hit them by the 2x4 if it doesn't work and say, look, it's a standard, damn it. How do we make it work? Well, inside the core, we're using BGP4 with unicast and multicast NRI. So it's using multi-protocol BGP4. And the purpose of BGP what's carried in the multicast part is actually unicast addresses, right? Those are the multicast sources. So the fact that the unicast topology and the multicast topology may not be the same is reflected by using BGP and have different NLRIs for unicast and multicast. So the information carried with multicast NLRI is used for RPF checks when you're doing forwarding, and it's also used for PIM when you're trying to build a distribution tree. So distribution trees get built the way the multicast topology is. We're doing PIM sparse mode. We're doing MSDP both internally and externally. MSDP is this protocol that connects PIM sparse mode rendezvous points together, so it tells other RPs about active sources. We have an IP address, a unicast address, which is our network-wide RP, And the network-wide RP is a specific unicast address that exists on loopback interfaces of multiple routers that are RPs, so they get injected into the IGP cloud. So whenever somebody's trying to send a PIM message towards our RP, it will hit the closest RP that is closest to him, measured with IGP metrics. Then our RPs are interconnected using what we call an anycast. Dorian, is he here? He's out, okay. They changed the net. There he is. It's his fault.
I think the, latest official name is a logical RP.
The latest official name is?
It's a logical RP hack.
Topological RP?
No, logical, sorry, a logical RP hack.
All right. We have a way of interconnecting RPs that works. It's really ugly. Here is how I looked at multicast topology of the universe, and I highlighted the most important ones, which is SprintLink and ICM. And we also have this legacy stuff here, which is called the M-Bone, which is run by this guy called Dave Meyer. It's an AS10888, and I view this as a stub network. And this is a suggestion. If you try to do multicast using native stuff, do it the way we did, and don't worry about the M-Bone stuff. Even if you have it internal to your network, you're going to spend more time doing seamless kludges than just saying, oops, it's legacy stuff, it's behind this box here. Okay, so the MD clusters, we changed name. It uses one loopback address to say this is the system-wide SprintLink RP. It uses loopback 0 as the system ID of the box. It's also the one we're using to source IBGP sessions. And this is basically the system identifier. And you have to make sure that this becomes the system identifier for both BGP and MFTP, because if you end up in a situation where the router announces this address to another box that has the same address, it's not going to work because it thinks it's talking to itself. So MFTP inside is that basically we have RPs. Okay, so we have RPs that talk to each other inside the network. They have the same address. So this customer out here, which is running PIM sparse mode, would have to hit this RP. This customer here, which may have a network on his own, is running PIM sparse mode, but he has his own RP. So that RP speaks MFTP to one of my RPs, and that is done to the system identifying address, not the RP address. And then I'm talking to my peers. And in reality, we have RPs in Seattle, Stockton, San Jose, Fort Worth, D.C., and Pensacon, and we only need one of them working in order to get multicast flowing between them, between users. You don't want to hear about this, but this is the most simple customer you can think of. He has a CPU router, he has a local area, he has a LAN, and he has hosts. Okay. Here he speaks IGMP. Here he speaks PIM sparse mode, and he can point at the RP inside my network. The only thing we need to do is make sure that his unicast addresses, if those are sources, get injected to my multicast and that arrive, so RPS things work. Okay? If they're only receiving, it doesn't matter. This is the most simple way of doing it, and it actually works, and there's nothing here. They can still do multicast on their Ethernet, even if they lose my RP. Okay, there may be a concern, and if you want to make this work, the only thing you have to do is point at the RP inside our network and then say, I don't want to listen to anything else, and turn on PIM, and that's it. If you have this configuration, you may want to use, you can still use PIM sparse mode and point at an RP inside my network, but you may want to be able to form multicast distribution trees inside this part of the network without being independent of me. And that way you have to make this box, for example, the RP. Okay. Now, this box is the RP for the boxes here, and it speaks MFTP to my RP. We still have the problem of injecting all the prefixes here into my MBGP routing table, but that's the same one. But now, this speaks MFTP, and you can actually form stuff internally. And you actually end up with a couple of more config lines, but not that hard. And it's really simple to configure, and it works just fine. All right. So this works, and if you're connected to Sprint, this is just there. You just have to turn your stuff on and tell them off. You want it. It's nothing special. It's no product. It's just there. You have questions about our multicast, send it to multicasting@sprint.net. Not that hard. That's it.